Uh-oh. This is a spooky one. Let's get one thing straight. I don't scare easy. I'm not bothered by most things people would associate with horror. There are, however, a few exceptions. One of them is things that look human, but aren't. I don't like dolls, puppets, dummies, and mannequins. This episode has one of those in it. If they don't bother you, then good for you. But if they do bother you, then we can cower together as we journey through this bizarre tale.
I'm not accustomed to such service.
Ma'am?
Well, there were a whole lot of people waiting for the elevator. I seem to have a private one.
Well, this is an express elevator, ma'am. To the 9th floor. The others are all locals this time of day.
Express elevator to the 9th floor of a department store. Carrying Miss Marcia White on a most prosaic, ordinary, run-of-the-mill errand.
Ninth floor.
There must be some mistake. There's nothing here.
Miss Marcia White on the 9th floor. Specialties department looking for a gold thimble. The odds are that she'll find it. But there are even better odds that she'll find something else. Because this isn't just a department store. This happens to be the Twilight Zone.
The After Hours was directed by Douglas Hayes and written by Ron Serling. The spotlight shines on one Marcia White, played by Anne Francis. Marcia is on a very mundane shopping task. She's come to a department store to buy a golden thimble for her mother. Nothing about her current situation is mundane, though. After the scene we saw, Marcia wanders around on this abandoned floor and eventually meets another woman who asks what she's looking for. Marcia is perplexed at the strange setup here, but tells her what she's looking for, the thimble, and the woman leads her over to a single glass cabinet that contains exactly one thimble. Every other area of the floor is completely bare. Marcia goes to pay for the item.
$25 even. Well, that's odd. What is Marcia? Well, you haven't any merchandise here at all, except the thimble. Except the very thing I needed. The whole floor, it looks so empty.
You called me Marcia.
Did I? I'm sorry. That was forward of me. I apologize.
How did you know my name?
I've probably seen you around the store.
No, you haven't. I've never seen you. Now, look, I don't want to make a big thing out of this, but what kind of a place is this? I mean, all I want is one small item, a gold thimble. I come up on a floor that hasn't a single thing in evidence except what I'm looking for. Well, you may be a little more sophisticated than I am, but this I call odd.
Please come again. Anytime.
Thank you.
Miss White? Are you happy?
Marcia, both spooked and annoyed, tells her it's none of her business, and the lady laughs at her, and talks to her in such a way as to convey familiarity with Marcia, even though Marcia claims she has never seen her before. She is thoroughly spooked at this point, and heads back to the elevator, which is operated by the same chap we saw earlier. On the ride down, she notices that the thimble is dented and scratched. There's no way she can give that to her mother. The elevator operator, rather coldly, stops her at the 3rd floor, which is apparently the complaints section, and lets her out. We then scene change to meet two other gentlemen. Mr. Sloan, the store manager, is being told by another employee, named Mr. Armbruster, that Marcia has claimed to have purchased a thimble on the 9th floor, as we witnessed in the earlier scene. Mr. Sloan looks incredulous, and asks Armbruster if he told her that the department store has no 9th floor. The two men, believing they are dealing with a kook, but wanting to appear helpful, go to see Marcia to sort it out. Sloan begins by telling her to bring the damaged item back to the gifts department.
Why don't you take it back to the gift department and...
Mr. Sloan, I just explained to Mr. Armbruster here I did not purchase this in the gift department. I was taken up to the ninth floor.
That's what makes it so difficult to understand. You see, we don't have a ninth floor.
I was taken to the ninth floor. I was waited on by a very odd woman. I paid cash.
Your receipt?
My receipt? I didn't get a receipt, but I paid cash. Look, I gave her a $20 bill and a $5 bill. She gave me this thimble and I... Well, there she is. There's a woman who waited on me, miss. Miss, I wonder if you'd...
You find out in the next scene, through a conversation with Armbruster and a female employee, that Marcia fainted after seeing the mannequin, who was, by her reckoning, not a mannequin earlier that day. She is currently resting, and Armbruster once again makes it clear that he thinks Marcia is crazy. We also learn that the store closes at 6 p.m. Now I know this was made in the 60s. Anyways, it looks like somehow Marcia was forgotten about, and we scene change to find her waking up on the couch she was apparently laid down on, and the time is 6:30, thus the After Hours title. She wanders around the store, and it doesn't take her more than a moment to realize she's been locked in alone. Well, I say alone, but that doesn't seem to be the case. As she tries various doors and calls to the outside for help, she hears whispering coming from around the room. They're all calling her name, and the voices seem, in her mind, to be coming from the still and lifeless mannequins scattered around the store. Well, I say lifeless, but...
Marcia. You remember Marcia.
Climb off it. Come on, dear. Marcia.
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 Come on,
we
dear.
Know. Marcia. Terrified, Marcia runs away, bumping into another mannequin who looks identical to the elevator operator. It is the elevator operator. She dashes into the elevator and is, against her will, taken back to the mysterious ninth floor. The doors slide open, and she is greeted by the mannequin who is the woman who sold her the thimble. She falls to the ground and curls up in terror as the mannequin shifts back into human form. The woman makes no threatening gestures, though. In fact, she seems to be coaxing her like a mother might coax her scared child. Eventually, Marcia comes with her out of the elevator as all the mannequins around come to life and travel towards her, all of them trying to get her to remember something. Finally, Marcia's fears turn to revelation as she realizes the truth. She is a mannequin as well. Turns out, the mannequins take turns masquerading as humans for 30 days, and Marcia had been overdue. The sales clerk and elevator operator came to life to try to get her to remember. Apparently, she'd gotten so comfortable, she'd convinced herself she was human. Marcia apologizes for being selfish and says she's ready to resume her true form and let the next person have a go at the outside world. The episode ends with this scene.
Marcia White in her normal and natural state. A wooden lady with a painted face who, 1 month out of the year, takes on the characteristics of someone as normal and as flesh and blood as you and I. But it makes you wonder, doesn't it? Just how normal are we? Just who are the people we nod our hellos to as we pass on the street? A rather good question to ask, particularly in the Twilight Zone.
A narrative device called tomato in the mirror is being used in this episode. If you're not familiar with the term, it is a narrative where the protagonist is not whom they appear to be, and they, along with the viewer or reader, learn the truth of what they are. It is a twist ending all about identity. We'll see this again in later episodes. Now that we're up to date with our narrative knowledge, let me tell you why I like this episode so much. The episode packs into an intense and bizarre atmosphere, and if you're like me and hate dolls and the like, manages a few legitimate scares as the mannequins come to life and interact with Marcia. Those who might think that the ending saps away tension from the episode are missing the point, in my opinion. Sterling is trading a slasher film-style adrenaline terror for a deeper and more thought-provoking creepiness. It is certainly more in line with the Twilight Zone's modus operandi to leave us thinking that mannequins are coming to life around us and view the next department store we visit in a new light than to simply line up a bunch of jump scares. Sterling sacrifices a cheap and easy win, as it were, to give us a more unique horror story that won't so easily get lost in the shuffle. I think Sterling can add horror to the genres that he can masterfully navigate through. The After Hours receives a perfect score of 3 fedoras.